about, I mean, where we ended the lecture was the role of human factor in application of work study. Now, if a supervisor or a work study person considers the worker as a machine, probably that's not going to work out because human being is a very complex entity. So, a work study practitioner first will have to follow certain rules while he's conducting the study. For example, some of the rules we can write over here. Like the first rule could be rule one. I say rule one. Rule one would be do not give direct order. Like you go into a factory shop floor and you see a worker is working. You can't just directly go there and say to him, now you work and I'm going to observe you. One should not do that. Rather, through proper channel one should go. The through proper channel would be the shop floor supervisor will be along with him, and the shop floor supervisor is going to go because the human beings are not good at taking multiple authorities. Probably, if only one authority is there who the worker has to be answerable to, it's better to involve shop floor supervisor. The second one would be, if workers are asking questions, calling for decisions outside the technical field of work study personnel, so they should always refer to supervisor. So I'm just writing that as always refer to supervisor. Rule three would be, never express opinion in front of the workers. Never express opinion. Because they can interpret it, the workers can interpret those opinions and then could use it in a different way in front of the supervisor. So that should be avoided. And a work study person should not allow the workers to play him or her against the supervisor. So, do not allow yourself to be played. Okay, so these are some issues. Now, although our subject is industrial engineering, but engineering also has the human aspects. So when you are doing a work study, okay, it's well and good you are doing work study, you've taken down some observations and all, but then for a worker, one should also see what is the motivation level of the worker, or what are the needs of the worker. First, in order to understand the motivation level of motivation of the worker, we need to understand the needs of the worker. Now, if I ask you guys, what are your needs? Let's say, anyone, what are your needs? As a student, if you have to do well, if you have to feel motivated, what are your needs? Anyone? Yeah, okay, let me help you. Of course, the basic needs of every human being is the same. We say that as physiological needs like food, shelter, and clothing, and all these are physiological needs. So, once these needs are met, what is the next thing that you look for?
Sir, access to study materials.
Huh? Access to?
Study materials.
Access to study materials. And then, once you have access to study materials, what is your need after that?
good
Let's say we
teachers
want to
then.
put that in a hierarchy, or we want to put that in a higher and the lower form. So lowest form of need is your food, shelter, and all those things, right? And what after that you say the accessibility to the reading materials and all that. And after that, is there any need above that?
Teachers and schools that can be teach.
Okay, anything about that?
Healthy environment,
Okay.
security, security.
Security, okay. Anything about that?
A goal.
A goal, okay. So, what would you say a goal of student would be?
So mostly it's securing a job after graduation.
Okay, so let me help you now. Making a pyramid over here. This pyramid represents Maslow hierarchy of needs. Maslow's hierarchy of needs. What is the meaning of hierarchy, anyone?
Order of different things.
Yeah, so order, or you can say a sequence of. So hierarchy is like in your family, what is the hierarchy? Maybe your great grandfather, if he's alive, or grandfather, then comes decision maker, father, mother, or grandmother and grandfather, then mother and father, and then your probably your elder sister or elder brother, and then you, right? So this is a hierarchy. So similarly here, Maslow is a very known person. I'm going to show you a video also, but let's understand what he says. He says that the primary or the physiological needs are the first thing. Please mute your mic. Whoever's mic is open, mute your mic. Physiological needs, safety needs, social esteem. Now, anyone's mic is open. Please check all your mics. Self-actualization. Self-actualization. So, let's start with physiological. As I've already told you, that these are the basic needs of anyone in the world. Or one goes to look for physiological needs first. So you can put food and shelter in the physiological needs. Then comes safety. Safety, as a human being, what do we look for? Safety, our surroundings. We would like to be surrounded by people who I feel safe with. Or I would like a safe working environment. Or I would like a safe job. Getting it? So safety is the, or job security, you can say. So sense of security. Once you have that sense of security, now you say, okay, now I'm fine. After that, you look for feeling wanted, that I should have some significance in the society, or people should want to meet me. So this is another social need which you have, sense of belonging to a team, a part of some group. So that is your next need. After that comes self-esteem, which basically means that I should stand out in that group. Getting it? You can imagine yourself when you were a kid. Kids generally have very less needs, like safety and physiological needs when they were born. When they are born, these are the two things that they start with. So as you grow older, you start becoming part of certain group, like when you are in 6 or 7 years old, you start to make friends and all. So you want to go in a group. You want to, as a human being, we want to join some group. Once you join a certain group, you want to stand outside in that, stand outside, I mean, stand aside in a way that you should have some different characteristic, or you should be the topper in that group. Like you join a class. Now you are in mechanical engineering. Many of you would aspire to top the class. Why would you want to do that? Because we have self-esteem need or self-respect. So kind of a status which you want. Once you get that, you would go to the ultimate one, which is self-actualization, which is intellectual. These are intellectual needs, and where would you would like to reach your final potential and achieving targets. Okay, so this is a hierarchy given by Maslow. So the objective of a supervisor or a work study personnel should be to take the worker to this level. Or the objective of management, as far as human resources are concerned, the objective of an organization should be to take their workers to the stage of self-actualization. Now I'll show you a video.
Is a theory in psychology. It's argues that there are five stages of human needs that motivate our behavior. Abraham Maslow proposed his theory in 1943 after studying what he called exemplary people, such as Albert Einstein or Eleanor Roosevelt. First, there are physiological needs, such as the need to breathe, eat, drink or sleep. The moment we get enough of that and we feel awake and our bellies are full, we get motivated by the next thing. Now we want safety. We try to earn money, build up resources, and look for shelter that protects us against dangers. Once we are satisfied and feel safe, we have time to think about what we want next. At stage 3, we seek love and belonging. We desire to be close to family and friends, belong to a society, or join a gang. But the moment we feel completely part of a group, we already wish to be a little different than the rest. At stage 4, we look for esteem, self-confidence, and respect from our peers. We want to be someone. If we have money, we buy a fancy watch. If we have a brain, we write or think or work a lot. Motivation to perform and compete is now at its highest. Students, sportsmen, and inventors excel. Neil Armstrong even flew to the moon. Only if we breathe and drink and eat and sleep enough, and we feel safe and part of a group and still special, only then can we reach level 5, self-actualization. Now we can relax, be creative, accept facts for what they are, give back or do whatever we want. No more pressure, unless of course there is trouble below. If you are a leader and believe in the theory, use it. First, make sure everyone has eaten well. Then make them feel safe and help them belong to a group. Once they feel they belong, they are ready to stand out and excel. Thanks for watching. Even if we try to
So this was about Maslow's theory. I hope it was quite clear in its own way. You people can also shed some light on it while you are. So what stage do you think you are right now? You can write your answers in the chat box. Each one of you. Most of you, yes, social, Sagar. Other people also, I want everyone to write what stage they think they are at. Ambuj 3 to 4, yeah. So only two people are there in the class right now. Three, social and esteem. Stage 2 and 3. Good, good. So it's quite right. None of you would find yourself in a stage of self-actualization, which is actually not the stage also for you to be in. It's too early for you to go into the stage of self-actualization. Esteem is one thing which you people all should be, I mean, people are not admitting it openly, could be, but most of you, or I could say 90% of you are in a stage of fourth stage, which is esteem. So you are looking, when you are already here, you are already part of certain group now. You are already in MNIT, so which is renowned in itself, and it's a very good institute. So you are now part of a group. You always wanted to be part of a fraternity, engineering fraternity. So you are here now. Now what you want to do is, all of you, you would want to achieve something. You want to stand out while you are doing this course. You want to get a good placement, probably best among all. And then once you'll be in stage of self-esteem stage for a long time. You will be again starting with the safety. Once you are there in the job market, you will again be starting at the safety stage. Or probably once you get married, you will be again starting with the physiological stage and then coming back, climbing the stage. So it's not like once in a lifetime you are at certain stage, you will be there forever. It changes as you move in the ages. Okay, so if you ask me, I am in a stage of self-esteem, and probably I'm going to be there in this stage for a longer period, because we are in the middle ages. So now let's come to this was about the human factors part. Okay. So generally this we finished this chapter 4, and now we come to chapter 5. Any doubts till this one?
So chapter 4 itna sa tha?
Yeah, you should see the book, all of you. I advise you, keep opening the book every now and then. The chapters are pretty small. You can say they are sections in a way. If you look at, there are around more than 25 chapters in the book. So now chapter 5 is actually working conditions and working environment. Working conditions and working environment. Working conditions and working environment. In this chapter, we generally discuss about few things like occupational safety and health organization, safety criteria, prevention of industrial accidents, working premises, good housekeeping, lighting, noise and vibration, climatic conditions, exposure to toxic substances, personal protective equipment, ergonomics, working time and work related welfare facilities. So I won't be going too much into detail, and I'll be sharing the slides with you. It generally requires, it's more of a self-study part of a situation in this chapter. So I'll quickly go through various things. So this chapter is devoted to avoiding and improving the working conditions. So as we can see in the Maslow's theory of needs, the second thing is the safety. So before you even go for work study, you should assess what are the working conditions at the pyramid step 2, where does the organization lie? So In this, they should strive to make the environment, working environment, safer for the workers. So, Occupational Safety and Health Organization, it recognizes, you can, OSHO, I'm writing, Occupational Safety and Health Organization. It is the most effective method of obtaining good results in the prevention of occupational hazards, which include specifying the employer's responsibilities. Because let's say if you are mining, if you are owner of a mining field, so what are your responsibilities as a miner? Or if you are owning a steel factory, so what are the responsibilities of the employee? So because the conditions are different in each industry, there are occupational hazards in different ways in every different industry. There's a lot of soot in steel industry. In mining, there's a lot of dust and dangerous gases could be released from the pockets. So these are the responsibilities of the employer to take care of. So they have to adopt occupational safety and health policies. And they should encourage strong participation of the workers in these activities. So encourage.
Sir, could you please repeat what's written above responsibilities?
Yeah, so responsibilities is simply that every different kind of industry has its own set of occupational hazards, right? So first, employees have to own the responsibilities that if I'm doing mining and my workers are exposed in those conditions, what are my responsibilities in order to help them out and not get exposed to those hazards? So strong participation of workers is required in achieving Occupational Safety and Health Organization. So it's organizing it in the activities which are involved in getting such organization would be organizing ways of allocating responsibility and accountability, training the workers, documentation of the occupational and safety hazards related things, communicating them. This is about organizing. Then planning and implementation. So once you have made the plan that, okay, this is how it's going to be. Now, we need to plan, and a system needs to be developed that how it has to be disseminated among the workers. Workers ko batana kaise hai ke ye is tarike ki safety policy aapko follow karni hai. Unki training karni padegi, unko batana padega ki agar aap aisa nahi karenge to kya problems ho sakti hain. Hazard prevention ke tarike batane padenge aapko. Then evaluation, once you have implemented it across the organization, over a period of time you have to, like every 15 days or every 6 months, depending on the severity of the hazards, unka assessment karna padega. Okay, and then auditing, investigation, agar koi accidents hote hain to unka investigation. And then continuous review of the situation. Aur kahin pe phir bhi accidents hote hain to unka action and improvement. So these are the things. Many of the things you will find that you can write on your own also without even me telling you. Some of the things would be obvious in this chapter. So safety criteria has to be established where you tell about occupational accidents which can happen. For example, the machines are there, like circular saws are there, spindle molding machines, power presses, or the substances are there which could be explosive, volatile, flammable liquids, chemicals, and all those things could be there. Unse occupational accidents ho sakte hain. So you have to establish safety criteria. Safety criteria for them. Establish safety criteria. Then, so we can say there are four basic methods of controlling occupational hazards. In the decreasing order, we can say that if 1, 2, 3, 4. If in the decreasing order of effectiveness, we can write them. So elimination of hazard is the top one. Elimination of hazard is the, you can say, top in effectiveness of reducing the occupational hazard, that is eliminate the hazard itself. Removal of individual from exposure. Probably you can automate it. Isolation of hazard. Isolation basically means that either you separate it from the remaining operations, or you actually zero down on exact cause which leads to accidents because of that hazard. And then you have protection of individual. Protection of individual. So here you can see the effectiveness decreases in protection as you go from 0.1 to 0.4. Protection of individual being means that you are focusing on individual worker and not the system and not the hazard. You somehow give him an equipment and he'll be responsible for himself. You wear this thing and you are then on your own. So that is the least form of safety which could be provided. Then there could be work related diseases which are which happen, like if the workers who work in silicon mines and all, so they get exposed to or asbestos, they get exposed to silicosis or asbestosis. So these are work related diseases. Or even IT professionals, they sit on computer for a longer time, so they are exposed to spinal issues or eyes, or even they may become obese. So these are work related diseases. So
excuse me, sir. Sir, can you please repeat isolation of hazard?
Okay. Isolation of hazard basically means that either, let's say, some gas pipeline is there, okay, and a guy is working on gas welding using that gas pipeline. So either you take this away from remaining shop floor, means isolate this hazard in a very separate place, okay, where only one or two workers will be there and not many workers will be. So in a way, you have secured many workers from that place. Or you find out if there is a leakage in gas pipeline, exactly what could cause that leakage, and you isolate that problem. That is the problem because of which leakage happens. So we are going to take measures so that that leakage does not happen. Okay, so that is called isolating. So it could be understood in two different ways. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So then work-related diseases are there where, like in IT companies, the workers are often asked to do some exercise while they are opening gyms in the company itself, where they can do exercise for sitting long after they have been sitting for long periods, or the workers working in mines, they'll have to wear masks or with the filters where asbestos or silicon or these kind of dust particles may not, or even in marble, they won't go inside their lungs. So work related diseases, these kind of options, or you can say problem solving approaches have to be sought after. So we can say work related diseases, they are basically cause and effect relationship and not cause and effect relationship with the work. So you can see that if there is a cause and effect relationship, like if there is a dust, there is a possibility that you're going to get a lung disease. Okay, so there is a cause and effect relationship in this. While let's say you, while in the other case, let's say you got a back problem already. Okay, now you are an IT worker. You are sitting on computer for at least 8 to 9 hours in a day. So it could actually aggravate your problem. It might not have caused it, but it can then aggravate your problem. So there could be that type of situation where there's not exactly cause and effect relationship, but then if the problem already persists, it may get aggravated. Woh zyada ho jayegi. Okay. So these are the things with which one has to see that. Means in India, the things are not taken that seriously, but then there are many European countries which take these things very seriously and they consider it for the workers. So then in the remaining part of the chapter, you would find that we are talking about prevention of industrial accidents. So this was about identification of work-related diseases, then the prevention of prevention of industrial accidents. Industrial accidents. Industrial accidents could occur in several classes. Like we have to provide fire prevention and protection. So these are some of the common forms which lead to accidents. Fire prevention and protection. Or then if you go through the book, they will tell that some, what are the standards of the industry, or the signals or the color codes which are used in fire prevention and protection on the shop floor. So I won't go into the detail of that. Then you have the ways when if the fire strikes in a workplace on a given time, then what are the features of preparedness for fire protection. So then you have another one is a major hazard control. So this is one example which has been discussed in the book. There are many other forms of hazards in an industry, but then this is one of the most prevalent and the frequent ones. So that's why it has been discussed in the book in detail. Then how do you do the major hazard control? Okay, first tell me, what's the difference between hazard and danger? Anyone? Difference between hazard and danger. Anyone? What is hazard?
So hazard is a very limited word, is specifically used for humans, while danger may be for anything.
One could say that
Sir, hazard could have long-lasting effects, whereas danger is more immediate.
Yeah, this is one thing. So, hazards are generally, as you said, the dangers to which humans are prone to are called hazards. And hazard is somewhat chronic in a nature. I mean, hazard is somewhat chronic. Chronic means long-term existing and exists with the system. So that's why we are not using word danger, but for in industrial usage, they say hazard only. So hazard control system would involve identifying hazard installations. So identify hazard installation, then information about the plant. Information about plant. So information about the plant has to be disseminated to the management that these are the hazard installation in our premises, and management should know about that. So what, and then the actions regarding those hazards inside the plant have to be taken. Like putting up placards or some signs or symbols or color coding, all these. Then emergency planning. Emergency planning has to be done. So these are some hazard control. We talk about hazard control systems and all. Then there's a discussion about working premises. Working premises basically means a factory or an office. So when a work study person is going to go to the work premises, he should know that when the plant is being studied, or if you are talking about a working premises, what are the conditions in the working premises? Are the lightning good? Is the lightning good? Noise, vibrations, and all those things are to be studied before you even go to. Because let's say I've seen one factory, and in that factory a certain work is being done in 10 minutes. I go to another factory and I see same work is being done in 15 minutes. So shall I directly come to conclusion that the factory B worker or the factory B workstation is not doing as good as A, or shall I consider A to be the standard time, like 10 minutes is the standard time of doing that work, or shall I also see the external conditions surrounding the work? Maybe both the workers are of same capability and working with the same passion, but the environmental conditions or the kind of machine on which the two different workers are working are different. Okay. So it is generally said that working premises should be above the ground level and equipped with windows having. So it is not suggested that you should go. Your workstation should be below the ground, like underground mein nahi hone chahiye aapke workstations. They should be at least on the ground level. They should have windows. They should have surface area of not less than 17% of the floor area. Minimum ceiling height should not be less than 3 meters. So these are all laid down by the ILO. And each worker should have at least 10 cubic meters of air. So it's also talking about ventilation and the availability of air. See, all these norms were developed at a time when the human exploitation for industrial usage was at maximum during World War II. So all these things which are mentioned in this chapter, they are relevant for developing good working conditions. So Maslow's theory, you can always refer why this, what is the significance of this chapter. It always refers to the second step, or you can say second point of the Maslow's theory, that is safety. Then you have good housekeeping should be there. Later I'll tell you in industry what is the significance of good housekeeping. Lean manufacturing, like Toyota, with good housekeeping Toyota has reached to this place where everyone in the world knows about this company and everyone wants to follow what Toyota is doing, because one of the reasons is good housekeeping. So, although it looks like cleaning job only, but I'll show you a video later that what good housekeeping can do to an organization. So this is another point, like arrangement of the tools also comes in the good housekeeping. Then you have talks about lighting in the premises. So under working premises, this good housekeeping, lighting, and you'll find that how lightning should be, it's given in the book. At what angle should it, if you're working in certain way, what angle should the light be coming from, so you could, and the kind of colors which should be there, how do you control the lightning, all these things you should be studying in detail. Then there's a talk about noise and vibrations. In the next class, that is on Wednesday, I'm going to take a small quiz from this chapter number 5, because it's a self-reading, so you should do that. So noise and vibrations, what should be the level of vibrations and the noise, and which is conducive for human working. Then you have vibration levels on the workbenches and the work tables. Climatic conditions. Climatic conditions like humidity, temperature, and what effect does it have on the efficiency of the worker. That and all is discussed over here. Then exposure to toxic substances. Exposure to toxic substances, providing the personal protective equipment, PPE, you can say, and the timings. So these are the most of the things which are discussed in this chapter, and the welfare activities. So I've also included few links in the slides where which you can see how work environment is created. So with this, I'm finishing this chapter basically. So you can consider that we have finished two chapters today. Yeah. So in case you have any doubts, you can always tell about it before. Like, don't say on Wednesday, sir, we did not understand this part of the chapter, so don't take the quiz and all. So you have to ask me before. Okay, so I'll be sending you the slides, remaining slides which I have not given you just now. Okay then,
sir. Book kaun si refer ki aapne?
Book ILO, I have already shared it.
Yes
sir. Sagar, please circulate that. I have already given you,
sir. I have already shared the book today also.
Okay. So that's it for today. The attendance, I hope every one of you have given the attendance. If not given, I'm giving another 5 minutes to fill up the attendance, and then I'll take it away. Okay then.